have been examining the sociocultural environment as far as the rural countries are concerned. This paper took us to organizational level. How is culture being applied to organizational level? At workplace, we observe that there are three major M's: demand, money, and machine. And the three interacted to ensure that the goal is achieved at workplace. This paper titled Impact of Culture of Accounting Information on Executive Decision Making in Manufacturing Industry in Southwest Nigeria. That was written by Akita Gienduwa Kemi and Adibayo Adureni Lanle. Two of them were absent for one reason or the other. That's the abstract of the paper. The paper focused on the impact of culture of accounting information on the investment decision making in manufacturing industry in Nigeria. This was the field of ascertaining the relevance of accounting information in taking effective decision as far as business organizations concerned in Nigeria. This paper adopted a descriptive survey research approach using a total of 453 respondents that were selected from the selected organization. The paper adopted opportunist shutter sampling techniques to select respondents for the studies using various strata of gender, departments, and levels of rank at workplace. This paper also focused on empirical data. The data were collected using questionnaires. Two major instruments were developed for the purpose of collecting data. The first one is accounting information scale. Second one is investment decision making scale. And the data collected were analyzed using linear regression analysis, Pearson product mean correlation, and t-test statistics at 0.05 alpha level. The findings of the study revealed that there is a significant contribution of information, accounting information, on decision making process. Besides, it was also measured that relationship exists between accounting information and investment decision at the workplace. If you observe most of the organization, some managers, they work out of the context of financial regulation. And if you consider what happened globally, especially in this era of global economic meltdown, many organizations are at the verge of collapse because of inability to take appropriate decision. Account information that we are talking about consists of all expenses that were expended, income and expended costs, which borders on the required costs and the running costs of organization. An amount of all this, when taken together, account for the information that has to do with how money comes in and how money was spent at workplace. In this era of globalization of economic meltdown, because we also observe that many organizations are after survival, adaptability, because they want to survive. And to afford in collapse, there's a need sometimes for diversification. If one business failed, you think of another one. So in the course of doing that, there's a need to consider how much they have, how much they have spent, how much loss they have, how much of profit they have made. All these are embodiment of information, accounting information. And in Yoruba language, it says that Owoniti Owasinile Kenekele Nomasidama Andreyo, meaning that if money is not available, nobody should think of anything at all as far as business is concerned. In other words, the viability of any organization is a function of availability of finances. At this level, I want to take us to well. The problem of this study lies on the fact that there are problems in how money is utilized at workplace. Are managers supposed to apply wisdom in the way money is being spent in order to ensure that the organization survive economic changes that pervade the globe? An objective as stated to assess the corruption that African development to determine decision making. Leadership was also established. And that takes us to the result. We measure contribution of account information as it affects decision making on investment. And by the editorial, and the paper revealed that there was a significant contribution of accounting information for investment decision. The second hypothesis stated that is there any synergism between culture of accounting information and investment decision? Look at the table over there. Many of us have done this for a longer time. It's a time to refresh our memory on statistics or mathematics. That table is a table of a Pearson Poulos-Mumet correlation, and it reveals that there is a similar relationship between account information and investment decision. Going further to investigate the difference between male and female perception of investment decision on the basis of account information, this statistics were utilized, and as a result, the male and female. The response revealed that both there was no differences. Both male and female equally perceived the relevance of account information to investment decision at workplace. Discussion of finding is there, that's the discussion of finding, relating the findings to the previous studies, and we found out that truly there was a relationship between the previous studies and the present one. That means that the impact of account information cannot be overemphasized. Conclusion. The final study established that account information has a significant influence on the investment decision-making process. And besides, account information was discovered as an effective tool that could be used by managers to ensure that organizations survive any economic changes or economic empowerment. And besides, the study also revealed that, or established that, without account information, any managers that embark on investment is doing that in vain. So factually and principally, account information is a very important factor in the consideration of decision making on investment at workplace. Recommendation was also made based on the finding, and made of organizations to place emphasis on the proper keeping of an accounting system with that standard expected of multinational organizations in order to enhance the value of account information for the organization. Also, organizations will ensure strict compliance to prescribe accounting information disclosure requirements. This should be achieved if the relevant regulatory agencies effectively pursue the discourse requirement recognized by the law, while making sure that corporate entities who default are able to face the due penalty, thus protecting innocent investors from under hack X.
That's perfect. I was just about to bring
up. This paper is looking at the human side of enterprise. The title of the paper is Impact of Employee Creativity and Innovation on Organizational Performance in Manufacturing Industry in Southwest Nigeria. It's a paper authored with Mr. Fakoya of Nevada's University, Las Vegas. So then we are able to bring the journal into the exigency of duty. The paper focused on the impact of employees' creativity and innovation on organizational performance in manufacturing industry in Southwest Nigeria. This was for the purpose of ascertaining the relevance of creativity and innovation on organizational performance at workplace in Nigeria. The descriptive research method was also adopted for the study. But the problem observed was that the impact of working environment on professional development has felt doom on organizational performance, especially developing countries like Nigeria, as a result of global economic America. Employee cognitive skill, among others, is one of the main factors that determine the organizational growth. If you look at what is happening in the developing countries of the world as a result of a global economic America, many of the organizations will not survive. Some have become moribund, some have since managed to persist. And as a result of this, the end result go back to the impact each employee will make at workplace. And that's called for how creative individual employee will be. The era of talent and knowledge management at workplace has proved to the whole world that organization cannot survive without employing creative and talented employee. And when they are even being employed, they must find a way of retaining them. For this reason, the paper determined to examine the relative and combined contributions of employee creativity and innovation to organizational performance in manufacturing industries. It also examined relationship between or among employees, creativity, innovations, and organizational performance. And we also look at the variations in male and female perception on the basis of creativity and innovation of the employee. Three hypotheses were set or were generated for the study. The first one determined the contributions of employee creativity and innovation to organizational performance. Second one looked at the significant relationship among employee creativity, innovations, and organizational performance. The third one also examined the significant difference between male and female responding perceptions of organizational performance on the basis of employee creativity and innovation. Research design. The design adopted for the study was descriptive survey, because they enable researchers to collect data without manipulating any variables. The participants consisted of 205 respondents drawn from manufacturing industries that operate in Southwest Nigeria, which include Indian Machine Tools Limited, Indian Buries, PLC, British Tobacco Companies, British Small Engineers Limited, and Dangote Cement Factory Nigeria Limited, where the process is ready for the study. The respondents were selected using purposive and proportionate stratified sampling techniques. Purposive sampling was utilized just to ensure that employees that have spent at least 2 years at workplace were made to participate in the study, while the proportionate sampling method was adopted for the purpose of selecting samples based on population. This letter did not have the same numbers of staff, so we have to pick based on the number of the population in that organization using proportionate approach. Stratified method was also adopted to select the sample or to select the respondent on the basis of the strata of gender, strata of organization, strata of rank and office, strata of age, and strata of marital status. To this end, we utilized three major scales to collect samples, because the paper is purely empirical. Collected data from the first, from the primary source. Primary source, we note that go to organization to collect information or data, you say questionnaire to collect all the information required. And the first one is employee complete assessment scale, which was developed by Rapatin and Hardy in 2012. The second scale is employee innovation assessment scale, which was also developed by Philip and Stroke in 2013. The two scales were developed outside Nigeria, but were validated to ensure that they are relevant to use in a developing country. The third one is organizational performance scale, which was developed by myself in 2011. That one does not require any validation, so it was used as it was being designed by the author. The scale were based on the premises of the five selected organizations in the Southwest Nigeria. The data were analyzed using multiple based analysis, t-test, and person growth moment correlations. And the results are presented as a table of multiple regression that combine the contribution of the two predictive variables, employee predictors and innovation to organizational performance. The results show that the two predictive variables, employees' creativity and innovation, have a significant prediction of organizational performance. That's the second table, giving us a stepwise multiple regression analysis for the relative contribution of the predictor variables. This table showed to us which of the two variables, creativity or innovation, are most important in the consideration of organizational performance. The table revealed that creativity is a byproduct of innovation. Without being creative, innovation cannot come. So in essence, innovation take higher score when compared to creativity. So in other words, the two sides of the same coin. Without being creative, there is no innovation that can be explored at workplace. We also look at relationship among employee creativity, innovations, and organizational performance. Are they related at all? That's the piercing product-owner correlation showing the relationship among the three variables. And if you look at the table, you can observe that the three are keenly related. So the study revealed that both employees' creativity and innovation has an important role to play in the study of organizational performance. Without employee being creative and innovative, little will be achieved by any organization. We also look at the gender issue, male and female, perception concerning the organizational performance on the basis of creativity and innovation. We also observe that both male and female equally perceive organizational performance on the basis of creativity and innovation. So discussion findings were made. And the policy implication is also indicated. The finding indicate that for organization to attain the highest level of sustainability, adaptation to work global environment, and gaining competitive advantage, creative employees should be given autonomy for self-directed decision-making and job performance. Conclusion. The paper established that there was a significant relationship among employee creativity, innovation, and organizational performance. That has not been established further that both male and female respondents equally perceive employees' creativity and innovation as having an important influence on organizational performance. Recommendations were also made. The paper recommends that organizational support systems that tend to combat physical, social, and psychological constraints on creative personalities, talent, retention, environment should be provided at the workplace in order to provide professional performance. Also, the working environment and condition of service of employees may be improved upon in order to afford them acquiring creative skills and the ability to cope and adjust to the pressure that they have to emanate from changes in organizational environment. However, creativity and innovation at workplace have become a proactivity and productivity-driven phenomenon that tends to foster effective organizational performance and increase output. Management of creativity and innovation, therefore, require attraction and retention of talent and skillful employees for competitive advantage and competitive empowerment. That's the end of the day.
Awesome.
So the topic of my presentation is Shell and the Nigerian government in the land, community perceptions to what. And so just the outline of my presentation, I'll go through a brief background literature, my research topic, aims and objectives, rationale for why I chose to do this study on the land, and just a theoretical framework, methodology, findings, and some of my because I'm currently still mining my data for some of my time, so it's still ongoing. So just my abstract, much has changed. I'm going to read it. Much has changed for your Yoruba people, but much else has not changed in the 20 years since the 1995 killing of Ken Saro-Wiwa and his 800 colleagues who were hanged by the Apache military regime for allegedly conspiring the death of Yoruba before. This paper critically explores the extent to which community perception in the land of Nigeria, in which community perceptions to both the Nigerian government and Shell has changed the 20-year killing of Yoruba man. And secondly, it looks at the relationship between oil and community development. And thirdly, it looks at the theoretical and practical implications for oil-led development in Nigeria, especially in Yoruba. Basically, I argue that in the case of Yoruba, in the light of the recent events of the 2011 UNEP report, UNEP Environmental Assessment Report, that captures the voices of Yoruba people and £55 million litigation settlement by Shell, which was hailed as an environmental victory, which for some people see as something that cannot be replicated within the borders of Nigeria. This research sheds light on the social, economic, and cultural impact of oil spills as seen through the community perceptions of the people during this two anniversaries. And so just to place my work within a timeline as to what is happening on the land, we have Mossad being formed in the 90s, and then I conducted my my research in some last year, so summer of 2015, 2 days after the presidential election, which occurred. And so just a brief, I'm going to breeze through this brief background literature. Ogoni Land has a population of about 83,000 people, about just above 1,000 kilometers in terms of size. Its population are mostly farmers and fishermen, and in terms of, it's estimated to be about 2.1 million barrels of oil has spilled in the Ogoni Land, and about 30 billion US dollars worth of oil has been extracted away from the community by Shell. And its Shell subsidiary in Nigeria is SPDC, and it has a joint venture partnership with the Nigerian government where they take 39% and then NNPC takes 55%, and then the rest are shared by other oil companies like Total and And so in terms of some numbers, Amnesty International estimates that between 2007 and 2013, 2,341 oil spills occurred in the Niger Delta region. And there's also a lot of research on between that reveals a lot of collusion between Shell executives and the Nigerian military in the 90s to the killing of so just so some context in terms of development, Nigeria ranks 152nd amongst 188 countries regards to HDI, and its life expectancy stands at 52.8 years. So my research question, I have three main research questions. What are the perceptions of Shell and the Nigerian state amongst the Yoruba people? What relationship do the people associate between oil and development? And what factors have led to both the positive and negative perceptions towards oil-led development? And so the rationale or the reason why I chose to do this work is part of the fact that it was last year when I was doing my research, was the 20-year anniversary of the killing, and also I felt that studying community perceptions to Ogoni people would help shed more light as to valuable lessons that can be learned from maybe other ethnic groups within the Niger Delta or abroad who are struggling with regards to oil degradation in their communities. And so the theoretical framework that I use is political ecology. I also am critical of the resource cost thesis, which essentially argues that resource-rich nations tend to suffer disproportionately from a lot of detrimental effects, such as less democracy, violent conflicts, authoritarian dictators. But I take more of a critical position at the bottom, where I say that it's a bit reductionist to ignore the existing socioeconomic factors that exist in including countries like Nigeria or other resource-rich nations, or the geopolitical economic environment that shapes the political economy that inherently creates this resource-coarse environment. And so I'm looking at this basically from the third world political ecology framework, which essentially says it explores the political dimensions of human interactions with the environmental ecosystem, and it primarily focuses on environmental issues, primarily in the global south. And so for political ecology is the complex relationship between nature and society through the analysis of access to control over resources and their implication to health and sustainable livelihood. And it also reveals the winners and losers with regards to environmental degradation. And it explores community level political action to regional level environmental degradation. And I also use the concept of degradation marginalization process in my work as well. So methodology. I went to Nigeria last summer for about 3 months, where I conducted 13 semi-structured interviews with the people. And I have the picture of Jonathan and Buhari there, because I arrived in Nigeria 2 days after the election had ended, where Buhari won. And the country was in election hysteria, where that's what everybody wanted to talk about. So I had to incorporate one or two questions in relation to my study to ask the people, because a lot of people wanted to talk about the election. So I felt it would be nice to have one or two questions in there in relation to that. So my participants were 13, 11 males, 2 females. A lot of them are generally educated with at least post-secondary education. Initially, there were issues around trust with being belonging to the Igbo ethnic group and wanting to do research in Igbo land. So there were issues around trust, and then there was also fuel scarcity and transportation costs, which limited my movement a bit. And a lot of my interviewees did not want to carry out their interviews in Ogoniland. They specifically requested that we do it in a location of their choosing in Otago, which I obliged to. And so just for some of my findings, a lot of my participants saw the UNEP report. Just to explain, the UNEP report was it's an environmental impact assessment report that was done by the UNEP, where they looked at the impact of oil extraction in the world. And the main summary of that report was that if we began today to clean up Ogoniland, it's going to take about 30 years to be able to clean up the amount of oil that has been spilled. And it details what each of the different stakeholders like Shell and the Nigerian government should do. So a lot of my participants pointed to that report as a possible solution. And another finding was that they were very highly critical, especially of the Jonathan regime, of lacking political will of governance. In the sense that a lot of them initially, what they said was they saw Jonathan initially when he was going out, they saw this as a great opportunity for at least someone being from the Niger Delta to address their concerns, but they were highly disappointed and looked at it as a missed opportunity. And then a lot of them were critical of Shell, and they bemoaned the fact that the impact of Shell regards to the health of people in the community. At the bottom there, I have a quote from Anagoni chief. I'm just going to read the last bit where he says, all the people still living on this land are living corpses, including myself. And in the interview, he went on to talk about how a lot of people in the community suffer from a lot of cancer-related illnesses due to the benzene from the oil that's been released into the farms and the waterways. And then a lot of them still view oil as a curse, in the sense that they've not seen any impact of oil positively, in that oil has destroy their farms, destroy their waters, and then there are no schools, there's lack of education. So on the one hand, they can't even make a sustainable livelihood, which they used to make prior to oil. But now in that they are being forced to catch fishes from the rivers, which are reduced size compared to pre-oil extraction in the communities. And then the Bodo community, which received a lot of participants saw this as an environmental victory for the Bodo community. In 2015, the Bodo community received a $55 million payout from Shell from a lawsuit for oil spills in 2008 and 2009. So this participant was, he's from the Bodo community, and he saw it as very positive, but he was, when I asked him if this could be replicated in other communities, he said it's highly unlikely because the Bodo community had a greater percentage of educated people within the Bodo community. So he was left optimistic in terms of it being replicated, not only within Nigeria, but within other Nigerian government. And then, so just to break up my findings, and their perception of the Nigerian government, they were hopeful of the Buhari regime and acting the UNEP report, which he recently has done this year, but then we're yet to see how far that goes. There was weak perception of against the governance, corruption, and a lot of people bemoaned the poor social infrastructure and substandard social amenities, being that oil was extracted from their backyard and they weren't enjoying the benefits of that, which kind of feeds into the whole idea of the paradox of and then the perception of Shell, a lot of them were highly critical of Shell, especially in regards to destruction of the traditional economy of fishing and farming, poor health effects. The only positive perception was from the Bodo community in regards to that initial payout, in that those payments were made. It was about 600,000 naira that was paid to per individual, and 3.2 million naira was paid to families, and they received the money in the cash payment. So they were the only ones that had a positive thing to say about Shell compared to the rest. And then in perception of how they saw themselves, a lot of them saw themselves as very peaceful and friendly, but then they also were aware of the violence stereotype, on how they're stereotyped by other Nigerians as being violence based on the actions or the things that happened during the Ibadan uprising in the 1990s. I'm just going to speak to them as I have a one. So in terms of my findings, I broke up my findings into my questions into four categories. For category one, who were the Ibadan people? I kind of mentioned that. For category two, the impact of oil, there was a lot of, also, my participant talked a lot about a lot of rural to urban migration. So them migrating to cities like Warri and Port Harcourt to look for jobs, meaning that they can't find work within their own community. And then talking about the Nigerian government investment of oil revenue, state Shell collusion, and it also feeds into the argument of they saw the Nigerian government as accumulating a lot of the oil. And so from my research, some of the recommendations that were made by my participants, so they call for a full enactment of the UNEP report. They also call for the passing of the PID bill. They also wanted a complete cleanup of all the oil spills in the Ogoni land before Shell can be allowed re-entry back into the community. They wanted greater recruitment of Ogoni people into environmental government parastatals like NNDC and NOTRA. And then they also primarily wanted greater responsibility and accountability from the Nigerian state in regards to environmental degradation in the Nigerian government. And then in conclusion, based on my study, I concluded that Ogoni Shell relations can only be forged when the ecosystem is completely clean using the UNEP report, with the Nigerian ecosystem taking a greater, with the Nigerian government taking greater responsibility in holding Shell accountable to the standards which they maintain internationally. And I conclude by saying if these things are not completely addressed, I fear that the greater ramifications of increased militancy, declining human development indicators, might repeat themselves, likely similarly to the violent episode of the 1990s, which might lead to an exacerbation of the symptoms of the resources, which might worsen in the future. Thank you.
Dear Chair, dear participants, distinguished guests, and dear students, good afternoon to all of you. My topic is modernization theories, the open ideas and African street with global smoke. First, in my research, in my article, I tried to explain the meaning of raw materials. For example, from Nigeria, oil approximately 5%, which for 95% of the revenues coming from the oil, like these raw materials. For Angola or Botswana, from the fish, etc., no, the raw material is nothing. It's like the whole economy. Thanks, my friend. colors he explained as the colors on oil. Okay, modernization, nature in authority positions Africa as a raw material base for global capitalism. In my topics as the international economic modern trade history, starting from mercantilist approach, but normally before the mercantilist approach, the meaning of capital is on slavery trade, the triangle trade from West Africa to the at the Middle Passage from West Africa to the Caribbean island, from Caribbean to the Negro. At the base of capital, of capitalism is coming from the slavery trade, because slavery is a labor, it was free, so you can, as a capitalist or developed country, become them. Africa becomes the bride of international capitalism and the backbone of its industrial expansion and hegemony. As an industrial expansion, the industrial revolution times, we are talking about the huge creativity by the developed countries. The source as the input was coming from colonized countries as a made of commodities. So industrial expansion started from started with the colonies, with the decolonization process from 1950s has come to today, market Africa's assistance to exploitation and total control of its vast resources, colonialism becomes an expensive instrument of containing. And later, by using modernization theory, they changed their strategy. Post-Cold War era, during the period of post-Cold War, by using these 4 points, I tried to summarize my article. Post-Cold War, I'm talking about Soviet Union countries, post-Soviet Union, Soviet Union, an era that marked the end of alternative development strategies provided by social socialism. The crisis of idea was institutionalized in Africa due to pressures from the international finance capital institutions like IMF and World Bank. Liberal traditions of development was institutionalized and consolidated in Africa through economic reforms driven by privatization and liberalization of policy of modernization theory. Privatization means, as a especially for the Africa, there is no capital. In order to make an investment, you need the capital. Capital is coming from privatization. First, the mining, etc. For example, my colleague explained on Nigeria. Now, especially North South, by start from the Lagos and Portugal, etc. The source is the oil. Oil is a raw material, but today, as a raw material, oil is nothing. The price is $30-$35. But in 2008, the price was reached to $140-$147. It means the loss of Nigeria, Angola, and other countries from one barrel, approximately more than $100 for each barrel losses. Modern African policymakers moved towards a new idea of sole trade and economic partnership. Normally, in these days, especially after 2000, the countries, including Turkey, changed their policy relations. They call this relation as a partnership. It means that one relation. With the emergence of the BRICS, as is a small because of its South African distribution contribution to the BRIC countries, I call it as a small S, nations in South Africa's economy witness tremendous growth and expansion. Modernization idea is an economic theory that is rooted in capitalism, which incorporates the full spectrum of the transition and drastic transformation as a structural transformation, etc., that the traditional society needs in order to become a modern industrial society. The main idea is coming from mercantilism, comparative advantage, absolute advantage. The main idea was to support the Africa and developing countries, to modernize these institutions, these countries. In order to modernize and support these countries, Adam Smith creates specialization. Specialized means you should specialize on what you produce. As Africa, they started from 16th century and later as a primary product. After the mining, they focus on commodities. But today, Nigeria became poorer and poorest. One of the poorest countries in the world. Okay. Use while the modernization is literally, they use the same kind of political and economic development followed the experience by the developed country of the North. As the North and South, the colonists words, North called as a rich or developed country, South we are talking about developing countries, except Japan, etc. Scholars from the global North labeled Africa as a dark continent which needed to be modernized by the privatization, etc. Okay. Africa became the weeping child of global capitalism for the capital, etc. They needed. World Bank and IMF becomes the institutional mechanism for the promotion, stabilization, imposition, and implementation of the principles and propositions of modernization theory in Africa, which is praised by developed countries. As a path of development for Africa and developing countries, African states should terminate the remove the use of subsidy. What subsidy means is a support by the government. For example, European Union countries, they created CAP as a common agricultural policy, which is supported, which is paid by the European Union. Its budget is approximately 100 billion euro. This is a subsidy. But on the other side, for developing countries, they said, okay, let's remove the subsidy because feel free for the developing countries, for manufacturing technology institutions to enter the developing or Africa. For example, in Nigeria, you will see many luxury cars, etc. Or in other countries, you will see these kind of products. They will have their nation currency, etc. But on the other side, they should appreciate by China. Till all government bureaucracies and embark on privatization. Privatization means who has a capital, they will buy all your institutions. Okay. All producer idea is in Nigeria, Angola, Venezuela, and others. For example, this is Sheikh Ahmed Yamani, the former oil minister of Saudi Arabia. All in all, I wish we had discovered water. Water. But as a oil producer idea, what about the oil consumer idea as a USA? But you know, the last year USA stopped to buy the oil from Nigeria and other countries. They create new technology for the oil. And what about Nigeria and other countries? There is no any capital to make investment, etc. West human and natural resources and revitalized Nigeria can be the economic and political venture of West Africa. Okay, on the other side, all of us can say, okay, for Africa has a strong comparative advantage in natural resources. So they should specialize on natural resources. But natural resource is nothing. As a oil, for example, Botswana crude as an diamond, but diamond as a crude is raw metal, it's nothing. Okay, finally, Africa, my colleague explained, you see, nature resource course, Dutch disease, who has an oil, etc. Industrializing growth, it means as an agriculture product, if you produce more, the price will go down and you will earn less. Your income will be less. If you focus or if you specialist on agriculture products, your income will be less. So you will be poorer or poorest country. Before we ask for quota, over-specialization, if you specialize on mining, agriculture, etc., you will produce more and the price will go down, same theory, your revenue will be less. Okay, such a transformation and economic diversification means as a share of agriculture should be less in your export. I try to explain by showing it. For example, in Angola has a rich unexploited deposits of mining. The country produced over 650 million barrels of oil per year in 2030, the second largest in Africa after Nigeria. The petroleum sector is the backbone of the Angolan economy, accounting for 98% of its export and 94.7% of the country's GDP. But less than 1% is the employment. What about 99%? Institutional trade. Okay, aid becomes the only vehicle for Africa's transition to development. Behind every aid given to Africa, there is always a condition attached. For example, if you need aid for African countries, they support your agriculture. because of food security. But it's nothing for Africa. To support Africa, so agriculture, you produce more, and so the price will go down, and which will remain for Africa. It's nothing. Food security for developed countries, not Africa. Thanks to God, many things in Africa, except luxury products, etc., but because of your car, etc., you can be alive. Okay, for Nigeria, you will see as a Euro 45%, etc. And on the right side, in 2010-2013, 99% of its revenue is coming from the fuels. The price in 2008, it was $147 it reached, but today only $40. Approximately for each barrel, they lose $110. Okay, as Africa general information, etc., West Africa, very small area, the city Europe, the share of the Europe as export approximately, you see, $7 trillion, 71% with European countries. This is intra-trade, the trade with other European countries. What about North Africa, North America, as a USA, include USA, $2.4 trillion as an export, approximately 50-55% trade with North American countries, with Canada, USA, and Mexico. As Africa, you see Europe, 36% as a trade partner of Africa is Europe, Asia, Africa. You know, intra-trade in Africa is 15%. And this is the meaning of intra-trade for the Africa and the other developing countries. The BRICS country, let me say very smooth. You see, this is the BRICS country as a GDP. Brazil, China, etc. You know, Brazil, China, India, and Russia, BRICS country. But GDP is okay. As a per capita, it means with, for example, with the, China and Germany. German population is 80 million, China population more than 1 billion. So your GDP can be higher than the other countries, but the per capita it's nothing. But the population, for example, about Nigeria, as a little, it is 170, 75 million, but normally more than 200 million are living in Nigeria. GDP has over the population, mostly we are from Nigeria. Let me share something with my friends.
I'll give you 1 minute before I get loud. Go ahead.
Okay, this is another commodity dependent country with Russia and Brazil. You see, because of the commodity price goes down, their GDP as a percentage decrease in 2015. It affected these economies. The other is a structural transformation, non-USA, 77% as a, you see, industry, services, etc., services. But what about China, 48, etc.? This is the other criteria of to being developed countries.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
thank you. We need to move on. I just received our reminder.
Let alone what? The economic transformation has been largely elusive in most African countries despite the impressive GDP growth. As a GDP and other, it's starting to be developed countries. This is not my idea. Usman Dore, I was there. African Development Bank, Nigeria Country Office. You mentioned these words. Thanks for your contribution and attention.
Thank you.
My paper takes a qualitative and quantitative approach, looking at explaining some terminologies and then identifying some challenges that sub-Saharan African states face as they try to participate in the global knowledge economy. I also identify some opportunities that need to be harnessed for better participation. I identify some systemic changes that need to be made in order that this might work. And I also draw some conclusions. These are some of the key words that feature prominently in the paper. The global knowledge economy, this expression knowledge economy was crafted in the 1960s to denote the gradual shift from agricultural-based or manufacturing-based economies to service-based economies. And you can see from this table, economies are classed around the world are classed into three depending on the predominant category of economic activity that drives it. Most of them have agrarian and industrial mix, but more of agrarian. Others have more industrial and a little sprinkling of knowledge base. Then there are others also that are mostly these days on a knowledge base. So typically you have the developing countries on the agrarian side, the lesser developed countries on the industrial side, and then the advanced or developed economies on the knowledge base side. And that conversation is about the movement of societies, especially with the production and consumption of goods. And in the knowledge economy, knowledge not only becomes the center of activity, but also becomes marketable. It has a value. So it's not just about what you fabricate, but what you're able to come up with to create and to translate into something concrete. And you can market it and have value and compensation for it. But this has been going on for a while, and the global discussion on the knowledge economy, which is fueled by globalization and the coming of information and communications technologies, this has not always had enjoyed a level playing field, especially when less developed or underdeveloped countries are involved. And sub-Saharan African part of the world tends to be on the tardy end of the spectrum. So we refer to the countries south of the Sahara Desert as the sub-Saharan African states, the home of some of the oldest civilizations, kingdoms, and we share a lot of these countries here share a lot of trajectories in terms of history, race, economies. Most of these economies are based on extractive industries, especially oil and all the solid minerals. They share historical trajectories, things about the history of colonialism and neo-colonialism, and even these days still dictatorships, and a lot of other problems that tend to bring them together, not just in terms of contiguity, but they share a lot of these problems that have inherited from the past and are still struggling with it today. So the sub-Saharan African states also have 48 countries and a population of about 980 million people. So a lot of cultural affinities here, as you can see on the west side, the east side, the central side, and the southern side. There are lots of affinities here among these people. So the problems they face often tend to be the same. So I identify some challenges to participation in the knowledge economy. One is the global intellectual property regime, which has been run over the years as a cartel that tends to give these countries the shorter end of the stick when it comes to the protection of intellectual property. So they tend to give it more often to Western countries, and these ones, the indigenous knowledge systems, they tend to be devalued and not handled for anything. So that is a structural barrier. The other challenge is the culture of dependence which these countries have developed over the years. They tend to be a one-directional flow of resources from the global north to the global world to the global south. And dependency of this kind tends to make you forget the value of local effort. It tends to downplay what you can do for yourself. And it also fuels a lot of interference from time to time in the domestic affairs of these countries. That's why the countries can't just steer their own course by themselves. And when you throw in corruption, it changes every dynamic. We have also insufficient or decrepit infrastructure, decay, disrepair, and abandonment, neglect, and a lack of culture of maintenance. It's so prevalent in the sub-Saharan African states. And even in some of the key cities, you still find that it's just not the case that we're able to put a lot of the things we need in good working condition all the time. So these tend to stop, cut people off from connectivity and being in sync with the rest of the world as we should. You have an existing knowledge gap, not because people on this side do not know anything, but they're not concretizing their things in terms of, you know, putting them in formats that they can sell, they can present before the rest of the world. Sometimes they don't represent themselves well in terms of content creation, so they tend to be a gap. Sometimes we hear sweeping statements about the region because the concrete things are just not there. So you have also piracy as the new normal. Many piracy, counterfeiting has a flourishing market in these countries south of the Sahara. So the problem with piracy is that it tends to discourage creativity and originality. If you don't get the full value or benefit from your work, you tend to be discouraged. After all, it is available everywhere. So policy-related constraints also play a role here. Lots of policy documents by African countries, sub-Saharan African states, from statistics I'm using for this paper, and some of the independent research that have been done by people, including data also from global agencies like the World Bank and the United Nations, a lot of policy statements, when it comes to implementation, they're just not feasible. In very vague, generic language that do not really translate into concrete implementation. So that's why we roll them out every year, but they are to no effect. So these are the problems, some of the big challenges African, sub-Saharan African states face. So what should we do? There are also great opportunities. Becoming more active in the intellectual property conversation. If you don't attract like a geographic indication, geographic origin of something that we do, or give it an indication that, denomination of indication that this comes from this territory, you can't get compensation for it in your economy. Greater regional and international integration, repositioning the educational system. We need to pass from just merely certificate, acquiring certificates, to acquiring skills that make people marketable in our own time. And in the knowledge economy, you not only present the paper, but you have to back it up with skills. So education system has to emphasize research and entrepreneurship among our people too. We're depending too much on white collar jobs. Potential sources of intellectual capital also exist today, like the ingenuity of indigenous systems, people who maintain systems and fabricate things, traditional things we have, like artifacts and crafts. We have also opportunities for content creation to get on the web, Wikipedia, and many other sources that we can represent things, concretize our knowledge systems to sell the indigenous knowledge systems than just download from the global map. The pharmaceutical industry can benefit a lot from us. In the deep, thick rainforest belt that we have, the lots of traditional forms of healing, the philosophies have been used by the Western medicine, people in charge of Western medicine, especially the holistic approach to healing, which we do not just concentrate on healing, you know, curing a lot of the symptoms, but we go into the root to see what is behind it. Opportunity for writings and publications. The more we write, the more we read, the more people get informed and we can be in sync. Opportunities offered by ICTs are very, very important. ICTs provide multiple networks for people to carry out goods and exchange services today. We can produce knowledge and we can sell and use this knowledge across distance and space. So you and I can say, one can be here, one in Nigeria, one in China, we work on the same Google document. Just log on it and we'll type in on the same page today. So you have a lot of other opportunities here, which for lack of time I will not go into. But there's so much here that we can do to get it synced. And a lot of skills that can win a lot of jobs, even online, a lot of freelance jobs in different fields, even beyond what you're seeing on the screen. So there are systemic changes that need to enable these. There has to be an understanding of development as an integral concept. So these days, government should not think providing access to knowledge economy should be a luxury to people. No, it should be seen. People have argued, a lot of scholars have argued, it should be seen as a right to citizenship in a knowledge economy today. We're in a knowledge age. And so providing this should not be seen as a big deal. An uninformed populace is a dangerous population. So a necessary war against corruption in all its forms, and then a necessity of cultivating a maintenance culture. So my conclusions are pretty simple. Knowledge economy needs not only global actors, but local actors. Sub-Saharan states are behind. There are changes, but there are also opportunities, and so much depends on the willingness of the sub-Saharan states to do much of their part. Thank you.
Thank you. So, sir, all the way in the back. Go ahead. Juan.
Just a quick question. I want to ask, in respect to your, a knowledge-based economy, in reference to sub-Saharan Africa, which country would you say is setting the trail in terms of meeting with the expectations of a knowledge-based economy? Which country would you say is setting some kind of a standard in respect to
sub-Saharan Africa?
Wait.
We're going to take four questions. Hold on to that thought. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. I want to ask Dr. sorry, I can't pronounce their name. You advocated evaluation of the currencies of African countries, if I got you right. But if you look, I mean, put your suggestion, your recommendation, on the perspective that you also gave about the lack of development of the productive forces in Africa. I wonder how you think that the evaluation of the currencies of African states will help in terms of boosting exports. I mean, you remember, you also clearly painted the picture of how African economies might be cultural underdeveloped and so on and so forth. What do you think, I mean, how do you think that devaluation is going to help in such a kind of economies?
Thank you. So we're writing our questions down. Sir, you're next.
Yes. Actually, my challenge is for the prof who presented on accounting and creativity and innovation. And excellent research material. But I live and work in the private sector. And I'm beginning to try and see, is there a nexus in terms of practical applicability of some of these things, some of these theories? And I want to also begin to engage the educational system that produces the workforce that is largely, to all intents and purposes, within the modern day context, unemployable. Largely so, because they have a lot of theories and a whole lot of that, but when it comes to marketplace application, you know, it's a total disaster.
Great, fantastic question. Number four, sir.
Comments.
Make them really short.
Sure, okay. First, to you, I think that if you look at Naomi Chazan, in terms of the explanations of why Africa is failing to develop, there are internalist and externalist arguments. I know you focus on the economy, but I think that it's important to look at that. And also, the political economy of development in terms of the role of the state. And then, as Gladaki would say, the need to contextualize development paradigms in Africa. And that's why, for example, Doro would say that in spite of our impressive GDP growth, we have failed to develop because we have also failed to contextualize development paradigms from the continent. And I think that you need to consider those in your analysis. And for Professor, it would be helpful if you go beyond the descriptive analysis of gender, you know, to do a correlation between gender, age, level of education, and marital status to see how they intersect. That perhaps will help the analysis more rather than just describing describing the gender aspect of it. I'm just talking about the gender part of it, and not anything else. Then for you, as they have the time, I have lots of questions, but I think that it's useful for us to also begin to look at the role that people themselves play in their own development or underdevelopment. So for example, did you bother to interrogate the role that Ugonis play in despoiling or degrading the environment through illegal refining? And then what did you also think about the views, the dominant views now in Ogoniland, that the UNEP monies should be shared, just the way the border monies were shared, amongst everybody. They don't want any cleanup. If people say they don't want cleanups, they've tried to organize for them to understand why it's important for the environment. You look at your political economy theory. The people themselves are degrading the environment, and they're saying, don't bother about cleanups, don't need it. We want the money shared, we want the money now. So how do these play out in the perceptions that they have about companies and the government without looking at their own role in their development or the development as the case may be?
Awesome. We have a couple minutes, so if our panelists, if you would take just 2 minutes, even if it's to tell where you're gonna meet them for dinner so you can give better answers and have better interaction. And we'll start with our first presenter, which was kind of one of our,
The question is on the area of applicability. That's the essence of these two studies. Employer will be concerned on the employer. They have no oral skills, resources to implement the idea, which we call strategic vision of the organization. And implementing this, that's how we go out and employ different levels of staff, different skills, and different educational background to ensure that this vision is realized. Are you hearing me now? And it is implemented on the part of the employee to ensure that they contribute meaningfully to the development of that organization. Why we have unemployment all over the world today is because of inability to account for the money being realized at a particular stage of the organization. Many of these funds are misapplied, some are embezzled, some are even lost in transit. So, lack of this proper account information led to inability of the existing organization to expand and diversify. Absence of this diversification and expansion led to unemployment. When an organization exists and expanding, more employees will expect to be employed. So it is not a matter of not relevance in applicability. Looking at the labor market, many graduates are not able to be creative. They just want to sit down in the office, get his salary at the end of the month. So employer that employ you is expecting some contribution from you. And agree to you for you to contribute, then would lead to problem of growth on the part of organization. And if employee refuse to contribute meaningfully, there's some way that organization can expand. And that is why all of us here, we see it as a challenge. In anywhere we are working, we are expected to contribute meaningfully. You see your creative ability to ensure that organization expand and factually assist not to absorb the future generation. So,
thank you. Onyekachi, do you want to answer some of the comments that were addressed to you? Go ahead.
Sure. Just so I'm clear on the question. So you were asking what's the role of women in addressing your community development, also in relation to things like oil bunkering as well. Oil bunkering came up in a few of my interviews, but a lot of my participants saw oil bunkering as being justified from their point of view, in the sense that in the absence that the Nigerian government cannot address your community development, and with Shell not being here, those pipelines being here, they're taking the law into their own hands to begin with. So a lot of them felt that they would stop oil bunkering if they actually see more avenue in the Nigerian part creating development. But then that doesn't still exclude the fact that what they're doing is wrong and they're still contributing to some of the things that Shell is doing with regards to polluting the environment as well. So there was that dichotomy on one side, in the sense that Shell was doing the pollution, but they were also doing the pollution with gas testing, polluting the environment. And there was also a study that came out, I think it was 2 years ago, by NIDRDF. It's a Nigerian research body that did a research and found that billions of dollars in gas has been made from oil bunkering in the Niger Delta. So I definitely don't exclude the people with gas to their role, but I'm more of the view that the Nigerian states has to take a greater preeminence with regards to oil, especially at this time when the oil crisis is being there. It's an opportunity for them to address the situation.
Awesome, thank you. Manuel, do you want to answer great question too?
Very good question. A study conducted last year by Africa Business Panel tried to rank the African countries as a whole in terms of how much infrastructure in the knowledge economy they have invested in, and they tried to rank them. So I just want to read out the first 10 names on the list. South Africa, Egypt, Nigeria, Kenya, Ghana, Rwanda, Botswana, Angola, Uganda, and Zimbabwe. These are the first 10 names on the list. Well, the list shows how much investment they've made. And in fact, it's the case of South Africa is very justified. When you come to things like e-government, come to things like telecom, giving telecom to the rest of the country. We talk about MTN all over Africa. It's from South Africa. So, but this ranking also recognizes that the African continent, especially the sub-Saharan states, still have a problem with generating enough sufficient power to power these things that, you know, hold together the knowledge economy. If you don't have sufficient power, how can you run things about the internet? For instance, we have 48 countries south of the Sahara, and with a population of almost 980 million people, but we produce the same amount of megawatts as Spain, which has just 48 million people. That's horrible. So while these countries have invested, there's still so much more to be done. Many of these countries south of the Sahara cannot boast of steady, uninterrupted power supply. That's a big minus.
Wonderful. Go ahead.
Professor, thanks for your question and thanks for your contribution again. About devaluation in economy, which I saw like this problem as a G curve, but it's not available for Africa. For example, if you talk about the cocoa, which is created, produced by the Guyana, etc., cocoa is raw material as a price to maybe $2 or $3. Sorry, raw materials, but as a Cadbury chocolate in Birmingham. A few years ago, I was there in University of Birmingham, and it was sold to the USA. The price of only one company is $23 billion as a cash. Chocolate is a final product, but as a cocoa, raw material, it's nothing. For coffee, as a Starbucks coffee, market value is maybe more than $50 billion, but only as a Ghana, cocoa producer countries, their GDP, etc., maybe less than only one company's revenue. The coffee price is $2 or $3, 1 kg. But only 1 gram or 2 gram coffee to create in any companies, the price starting from $3 or $4, or maybe $5. And the other thing, as a oil, raw metal, it's nothing, or in Botswana, diamond, etc., diamond, but especially Belgium, etc., they added their value as a final product. So, the devaluation of the money, for example, in Nigeria, the Naira was 120, 40, later exceed to the very close to 300, maybe more later, the president come back to the Nigerian decrease. But it will not affect, it will not encourage or boost to the economy for export. Because as a Nigeria, their economy own raw materials, primary product, basic. So it will not affect and encourage to developing countries' economy to devalue the currency as a Naira, or in Russia, for example, they devalue their currency because the Russian economy depends on oil and gas. As a final product, no any technological products. Include and other countries, I can give an example about these topics.
Thank you so much. If you will help me thank our panelists.